other problem we have is that the parliaments, through their premiers and ministers of health, have given additional powers under these acts to the public health officers, which should never have been done. The public health officer doesn't report to you and me. Mm-hmm. Public health officer reports to the minister and the premier, and it's the minister and the premier who report to you and me through their parliament, which should be open overseeing this so-called emergency, okay? That's what should be happening. So that free and democratic society provision tests, number four, that's the other thing that hopefully I'll be able to argue before the appeal courts or the Supreme Court of Canada, is that even if this section one did apply, and I argue vehemently it doesn't, I remember well, because we were very cognizant of the time we were talking about a constitution, not a federal act, not a provincial act. This was a sacred document. We were putting sacred rights into a sacred document for permanence sake. That's why it wasn't like the Bill of Rights in 1960, because it was only a federal act. It didn't have the same power. So we knew that at the time. This was not new to us. We knew that. And so even if it did apply, Section 1, just for argument's sake, none of the governments have met those four tests. So everything they're doing, therefore, is completely and unadulteratedly unconstitutional.
Well, now let me ask you a question, because I would never ask you to try and speak for other premiers who were deceased and who many of which I'm sure you haven't talked to in decades. But instead of that, perhaps you could just share with us some of the spirit of the times, what some of the premiers or even the prime minister and the federal justice minister, because, I mean, I have many quarrels with the late Pierre Elliott Trudeau, Justin Trudeau's dad, but I think he occasionally showed a flash of civil liberties. I mean, he brought in the War Measures Act and all, but I think this charter, he was trying to enshrine real civil liberties, and I don't know if his son cares about that. Can you tell us, I'm not asking you to speak for them, in today's
court. Right. No, I understand what you.
Was there something back then that this premier said or that justice minister said that if people today heard, they'd say, yikes, we've fallen far from the intent of the original drafters of this legislation?
Okay. Well, let's just get the historical context correct. Pierre Elliott Trudeau's version of the Charter and of the Constitution Act failed. We came together as first ministers to see if we could patriate the Constitution, bring it home to Canada, no more have to go back to London for amendments. We were a complete and utter sovereign nation. That's part of what's in the Constitution Act 1982 and the Charter. And so we sat down and started to negotiate in 1980. But halfway through, the Prime Minister, Justin Trudeau's father, and this is not promulgated very much anymore. And every time I mention it in the speeches I give, the community halls that I go to and give these speeches, there's a hush in the room. Nobody remembers. Nobody has been told that the Prime Minister of Canada at the time left the table halfway through and said, I can't negotiate with you guys. You're too difficult. And so he left the table, and a number of us, by the way, in the room at the time, including René Lévesque, by the way, had said, Trudeau won't stay at this table. Trudeau won't stay at this table. I said he would, and a number of others said he would. We were wrong. I think Sterling Lyon said that he wouldn't stay. I think Peter Lougheed had some questions about it, okay? So I want to give you the sense here. So he left the table. We thought he would return to the table a few weeks later, whatever. What did he do? He initiated an act through the House of Commons unilaterally to patriate the Constitution and his version of the Charter. He figured he could do it on his own. We took him to court. Three court actions happened, one in Newfoundland, one in Manitoba, and one in Quebec, challenging his constitutional authority to do what he did through the House of Commons. At the same time, Conservatives were agitating that they didn't think the Prime Minister could do this, as so were some of his MPs, quietly saying this. Anyway, to make a long story short, on September the 28th, 1981, the Supreme Court of Canada ruled that what the Prime Minister of Canada was doing was unconstitutional. Hmm. He could not do it without the provinces. Hmm. He needed so many of the provinces in order to be able to do this. So his version of the charter, his version of patriation, went up in smoke. And he was forced back to the table. And he came back to the table for those last 3 days, November 3rd, 4th, and 5th. And it was a proposal from the provinces, from yours truly, on behalf of the provinces, over the night of December the 4th into the morning of November the 5th, that led to what we have today. It wasn't Trudeau's proposal. Trudeau's proposal was defeated by his own court, the Supreme Court of Canada. Everybody forgets that, and it's muted. When you go to the encyclopedias and you go to the various books on the patriation of the time, this is muted, as if, because so many people want to elevate Pierre Elliott Trudeau to be this great scholar and this great genius as related to the Constitution. Well, sorry, folks, it was Pierre Elliott Trudeau's proposal that failed, and it was the provinces' proposal that won the day with the Prime Minister on side, because, of course, he just got defeated a few months ago before that in the Supreme Court of Canada.
That's an excerpt from my daily show, The Ezra Levant Show. Every day I do a monologue on the news of the day, then I interview an interesting guest, and then I read my hate mail. You gotta subscribe. Go to rebelnews.com.